As we have assembled together for God's glory, we welcome those who have joined us on live stream also. Tonight we're going to be in Jude, the first chapter in verse 24. We'll have one more exposition after this in the book of Jude, then we'll begin the Gospel of John. Now, for the last 20 centuries, I think that's 2,000 years, for the last 20 centuries, the challenge has been to convince the redeemed of how much God has done in Christ Jesus. It never really has registered on any significant scale from day one. The most extensive revelation of it appears to have been in two areas, Jerusalem and Antioch. But it's like Satan was especially active in this area to hide from people what God had done in Christ. And you'll sense this in the apostolic writings. If you can pick up on it, there's like a holy exasperation that people didn't see any more than they did. I wasn't that way with everybody, but it almost was, that there always was more. That's why the Apostle Paul particularly, he prayed for the opening of their eyes, that God would give him understanding, that God would show him, you know, that's why he said that. Because he sensed that much more has been done in salvation than the average person, or even the exceptional person, has perceived. It's actually kind of a phenomenon. The Corinthians failed to see the significance of being purchased by God. Paul had to remind them of this. You're bought with a price. You're not your own. See, they didn't see that. So Paul ministered to them. The Colossians were facing the intrusion of philosophers. The Galatians had gone off the edge and left him that had called him. The Hebrew believers had lost sight of the high priesthood of Christ and were reverting back to the law. The ones to whom James and Jude wrote were off the chart. Jude and James, they were off the chart. He didn't even recognize them hardly as legitimate. Jude faced it. Several of the churches that Jesus spoke to in the Revelation, they were flawed in this area. See, this has been a consistent problem. And one of the biggest concerns that I personally have, is how little is said about this kind of deficiency in our Christian society. It's just kind of baby pebblem tossed out to the people. Let's all be nice and share our toys, that kind of mentality, and God is good, and God understands where you are and loves you just the way you are. And the fact that more's been done for humanity than those who wear Christ's name have dared to imagine. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And Jude's dealing with this right now in his letter. Those to whom Jude wrote didn't have a clear understanding of faith. That's why they didn't contend earnestly for it. That's why he had to stir them up. Because they didn't have a proper and adequate understanding of what faith does, or else they've been earnestly contending for it, you see. And now with the necessity of maintaining the faith, as hardly anyone says anything about this today. Now, I know that some do. I'm saying this is the general tone. The modern church is actually like a church, like a car without an engine. That's what it's like. Doesn't have any power. everybody knows it doesn't have any power, but not many people will actually say this, but everybody really knows it. It's a limping along. It's got to solve all kind of problems among its membership. It's a serious situation. That's why Jude wanted to write about the common salvation. That's what he'd prefer to write about. He couldn't do it. Not to these people. He couldn't do it. They were in such a dangerous situation. He had to stir them up. That's what I see us having to do. The modern church, the thing that has complicated things is the introduction of Christian higher education and institutionalism and popularity and Christian fads, and this is complicated, so it's worse now than it was in Jude's days. It's as complicated, the whole situation, but the same message that Jude preached is the message that's got to be preached today. Anyone that draws back from this, that's a professed leader, I pray against them. They have no business. They have no business standing before God's people if they're not going to address this situation that exists and is so prevalent. Now the text we have tonight introduces one of the great aspects of salvation that men argue about.
Yeah, yeah.
You may believe this or not, but the Christian community argues about the text we're going to face.
Yeah, uh-huh.
This is not a text to argue about, it's a text to proclaim.
Amen.
And here it is, now. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the posture of the whole book.
Yeah.
Not then, uh-huh. Not was, now. Unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. And that's the part we're going to deal with. Now, some other versions say, but unto him. Some say, and unto him. Some versions say, and now, Living Bible says, and now. But most modern versions omit the word now. They don't even use it. But for those that are interested, it happens to be in the original language, as they would say. It's a word that speaks of extending the thought. He said, I'm not done talking yet. That's what this word means. Now, based on what I've said, see, that's what it's, now based on what I've said, now extending this thought that I've been saying, I want to end on a high note. Now, I understand this kind of speaking, extending the thought, is characteristic of the Hebrew language. That's what linguists have told me anyway. That's a characteristic of the Hebrew language. It's like thoughts are extended. See, but we've got the people who are supposed to know but do not know tell us that man's attention span is only so long. See, they're not.
Yeah.
Nobody told the movie makers this. Have they? Have they?
No.
No one's told the sport people. No one's told them you got this brief attention span of 20 minutes. Nobody's told them.
Yeah.
The politicians sure don't know it. They'll have a convention all day long. They don't know anything about short attention spans.
Uh-huh.
Revolutionists don't know anything about this. Just the church talks about it, that's all.
Uh-huh.
See, this Jude not talking to people with short attention spans.
Uh-huh.
Jesus didn't either. None of the other apostles did either. When they'd say something, they expected you to remember what they had said before that. In fact, all the epistles are like that. Some epistles, one sentence would be like 10 verses. They expected you to have the ability to think an extended thought, keep everything connected, keep everything associated, and the purpose is to come to a conclusion. See, that's the whole purpose. You've got, God wants us to arrive at a conclusion where we see the sense of what was said. So that's what this now is there for. It's addressed to people that have ears to hear. See, it boils right down to it, having ears to hear is being able to draw a conclusion from what you heard. To say, well, that being the case, I can see and draw the conclusion. So Jude now himself is doing what he expects his readers to do, to carry on this extended thought. It must be done, this thinking must be done while what he said is in the mind. Yeah. He's not asking people to spin off on some kind of unrelated thinking. But you'd be surprised that there is an enormous amount of preaching, has been for quite a few decades now, that teaches people to hear the Bible and then think about something else. Why, I've heard thousands of sermons, the sermon text is read, and then the preacher doesn't say anything about the text. One black brother that I know said they use diverse diseases. He was commenting on that verse, diverse diseases, and he said there's a lot of diverse diseases. Some people read the text and then dive into another subject. That was what I said, well, maybe you're onto something there. I want you to see what I'm saying here, that this idea of extended thinking, building on what you've been taught, that's what Jude said. He's building on what he said. Now, in continuation, unto him. And I like the word unto. Some say to, but unto is like a fuller. It's a fuller word. To says you're pointed in that direction. Unto says you're going in that direction. There is a little bit of difference in the two words. Now unto him. The Good News Bible says unto God. Well, that is what he's talking about. I understand. Yeah. New American Bible says unto the one. The Living Bible, it waxed eloquent. Here's how it translated, unto him. Here's how it translated that. All glory to him who alone is God, who saves us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Yes, splendor and majesty, all power and authority are his from the beginning. His they are, and his they shall be forever, there shall forever be. That's there. Well, I was telling you, see, whatever may be said of that, the fellow knew, he saw. There's a lot in this. There's a lot in this. The Contemporary English Bible says, offer praise to God our Savior because of our Lord Jesus Christ. And the English Revised Version just says, and God. That's for the word now. That's what they say instead of now. Now you can detect, as I said, from these various versions, that this is a large consideration. This is like a big thought he's going to set before us. You can't hold this in an academic bag. You're going to have to think. See? Now think of the centrality of God and what Jude has written to this point. He wrote to those who are sanctified by God, the Father. He said, ungodly men turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. He said, these men were denying the only true God and the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, the Lord saved the people out of the land of Egypt. The Lord afterward destroyed them that believed not. It was God who reserved the angels to judgment of the great day. It was God who set forth Sodom and Gomorrah as examples to those who would thereafter sin. It was the angel Gabriel. It was the angel Gabriel called upon God to rebuke the devils. I'm showing you here that God was at the center of what he said. Enoch prophesied that the Lord comes with 10,000 of his saints. Judas admonished the saints, keep yourselves in the love of God. See, so God's been at the heart of everything he said. So I conclude, the God. Now to him. Unto him. Just look toward him for when I say what I'm saying now. Consider him. The others haven't been considering God. You've been listening to men that didn't consider God. You ain't gonna listen to men that crept in unawares that ported you away from God. I'm telling you, look now, think about God when I say this. Now unto God that is able. Now, I could squat on this a lot longer than I did, but that is able. We might say, who is able? One verse, good, God's Word Bible says, God can. Well, that, I don't know. That I just don't prefer that. And who has power to? Oh, I kind of like that. The word able means to be able to do something.
Amen.
In the divine economy, ability does not have to do with potential. Mm-hmm. See, if in mankind, when you say able or ability, you're thinking of potential. Mm-hmm. This isn't what God's thinking about. There's God, you can't think of God as potential, having anything potential. This is able, like now, whatever, to do. He's able. He's able. Now, there are several things inherent in the word able. One is that the ability is in the nature of God himself. It's not an acquired trait.
Yeah, amen.
Any ability you've got, any ability you got has been acquired. You didn't have it when you were born.
Yeah.
It was acquired. So this is not a trait God acquired, or one he developed, or because he used it a lot, it got better. That's all man. That's not God. And he must have the authority. See, he's got to have the authority to do it. Not only the ability, he's got to have the authority to exert this, whatever he does, without any controversy or any kind of contention. And the ability can't be negated by anybody else. He's able. That's all in able, see. The power can only be used at his discretion. Nobody can borrow his power. He uses it. He can confer it, give someone else the ability, give them power. Jesus gave them power to heal lepers and raise the dead. But it was inherent in him, and he could use it at will. There's no circumstance that can effectually negate that power. The only way the power is not present is if God withdrew it. You got to hear what I'm saying here, because this has some alarming ramifications. The only way the power of God was once here and is not anymore is not that any other competing power overcame it. It's not that some circumstance neutralized it. It's that God withdrew it.
Amen.
All right, now you got to hear what I'm saying here, because this, if the church is powerless, God's withdrawn it.
Yeah. Amen.
I don't know how you could, how is anyone have any other solution? How could God give, the church once had power. How could God give power in generation A and in generation X, the supposedly same institution doesn't have power? How do you account for that? I'll tell you how. God took it back.
Yeah, that's right. Yep.
God won't leave his power in somebody's hands who do not use it for his glory.
Amen.
No one has the argument with that, do they?
Yeah.
I mean, that should be pretty plain. But see, it has kind of is it kind of is alarming, huh? Because if a person's working with a group of people they think are Christians, but there's no power. You say, are you saying they're not Christians? Ah, that's not up for me to say. But I'm saying if they are, they got to have this power to some degree. The power's got to be there. They've got to have power to resist the devil. Somehow it's got to be there. They got to have power to keep the faith. Somehow it's got to be there. They got to have power to seek the Lord. Somehow it's got to be there. See, it's got to be there somehow. They got to have power to preach the truth. They got to have it. It's got to be there. If it's not there, That's why they don't do those things. Now, because these things are true, God has, he's able, he's fully able. Nothing can diminish his ability.
Yeah, amen.
Now, that's why we can say such things as, we can ask questions like this. Is anything too hard for the Lord? See, that's why, the reason we can ask that is because he has this ability. He really does. Here's something else. Is the Lord's hand waxed short? How can we ask that question? Because God does have ability. Who is a God like unto thee? Micah said, see? Think of the affirmations in Scripture that are made about God that presumes this ability. There is no restraint with the Lord to save with many or few. That's what Jonathan said. He is mighty in strength and wisdom, as Job said. I know thou canst do everything. That's what Job said. The Lord reigns. That's what David said. For the Lord is a great God and a great king of all gods. That's what again what the psalmist said. Who is a God like unto thee? Micah said. With God all things are possible. That's what Jesus said. God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. That's what Paul said. He's able to subdue all these things. See, these are the assertions about God. See, no circumstance should challenge us so that we think nothing can be done about it. We can't make it be done. I understand that, but we've got to believe. We've got to believe this. That God is able. This has got to be on our hearts and minds. We've got to tell it to one another often because the flesh doesn't want to remember this. Mm-hmm. It'd like to think God couldn't.
Yes, amen.
But he's able, yes.
You know, they have never yet come up with on earth a source of power that regenerates itself. Everything either has to be plugged into something that is generating electricity somewhere else and is piped to us, or they got to put a battery in it. But the problem is that it always runs down.
Yeah.
Nothing has power in itself. Only God.
Only God.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
See, it's time, brethren, well past time. And maybe you're in the, I think most of you are in this category already, but it's time for people to think of God as the one who is able. One with whom all things are possible. That's how we got to pray. It's why we have to think. It's why we have to have faith. We have to walk the walk with this in mind. God's able. No limitations. You don't. That doesn't mean you have an answer to all the questions. You don't have an answer to all the questions. But you must have faith on this matter. You must believe that with God nothing is impossible, not even a thing that stymied you. It's not impossible.
Amen.
God is able. But now, Jude narrows this down. As I say, now we're going to talk about something that people argue about, have debates about. He is able to keep you from falling. All right, that's what we're going to look at. He's able to keep you from falling. As I said, that affirmation is boldly denied by no small number of people. I remember when I was kind of caught up in this myself as a young man, we'd be arguing with somebody that believe in what they call eternal security. And I'd say, well, you can fall away. Which you can. I mean, that don't make no mistake about it. But the thought came to me one day, is there anything else you believe? Is this kind of as the summary of your belief that you can fall away? Is this really our message? You can fall away? Is that what we're preaching? Well, a lot of people are preaching that. You can fall away. Well, that's true, but that's not the message.
Yeah, that's right.
That's not the gospel.
Uh-huh.
You got to have to tell this first to them. God is able to keep you from falling.
Amen. Yeah.
Don't anybody try and talk me out of that. I need that.
Amen.
I need to hear that.
Yeah.
Why? Because I can't keep myself from falling.
That's right.
Oh, someone may give me a plan. Say, looky here, here's a plan. I've thought up this plan. If you do these so many points, you won't see. But I know that's just a lot of gobbledygook.
Yeah.
I know that no man can keep me from falling. No plan can keep me from falling. No resolve can keep me from falling. But God can.
Amen.
God can keep you from falling. He is able, fully able,
yeah,
to keep you from falling. All right, now when I know that in my heart, now I read, you're complete in Christ. Oh, boy, that.
Yeah.
Now that means something to me now.
Yeah.
See, the degree to which you partake of this, he's able to keep you from falling. You say, well, Brother Blake, you don't understand what I'm going through. He's able,
yes,
to keep you from falling.
Amen.
You feel like you're about to fall. You feel like you're about to give up. You feel like things are closing in on you. He's able to keep you from falling.
Amen.
So I hear that and I say, all right. Now go on to perfection seems doable.
Yes, amen.
Huh?
Yeah.
Ah, now this is doable. Go on to perfection.
Yeah,
you tonight, go on to perfection. Huh?
Mm-hmm.
You sitting there now, go on to perfection. Well, nobody can be perfect. Go on to perfection.
Yeah.
Our God is able,
amen,
to keep you from falling. Cleanse yourselves of all filthiness of flesh and spirit. Well, nobody's perfect. Cleanse yourself.
Yes.
Just shout it a little louder.
Amen.
Cleanse yourself from all filthiness of flesh and spirit. Well, how can I do that? God is able,
amen,
to keep you from falling. And if you don't, if you don't cleanse yourself of all filthiness of flesh and spirit, you will fall.
Amen. Yeah.
This is how God keeps you from falling.
Right.
He gives you the power to do what he says to do.
And Brother Given, if you're looking at somebody and it seems like their candle isn't burning as bright as it used to be, you can think, well, God, doesn't it say that thou wilt light my candle?
And light my candle. Do not quench your smoking
flames.
Amen.
That's right.
You can read, let not sin reign in your mortal body. Don't let it do it.
Yeah.
Well, I went and got drunk again. I'm. God is able to keep you from falling. Stop trusting in that blooming plan and start trusting in God.
Amen.
See? It got personal.
Mm-hmm.
Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body. Don't let it. Don't let it.
Amen.
It'll try to. Don't let it. Say, how can I not let it? God is able,
amen,
to keep you from falling.
Yes.
Here's one. Keep yourself pure. 1 Timothy 5:22. We dedicate that to all young people that are just starting out in adulthood,
yeah,
like Timothy was. Keep yourself pure. Say, well, it's hard to keep pure with all this stuff going on around. God is able,
yeah,
to keep, yeah, you from falling, which involves keeping you pure.
Yeah.
Well, this three times the scripture says, sin not.
Mm-hmm.
Just two words. That's a sin not. Yeah, how can I? Nobody sins not. Well, after you've said all the nobodies, sin not.
Yeah.
Now, the only way that can make sense to you is God is able,
yeah,
to keep me from falling. Oh, I love it.
Yeah, amen.
Whenever sin surfaces in our lives, don't seek to excuse it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't say, well, we all make mistakes. We're weak. Don't strike all that from your vocabulary.
Yeah.
We know that already.
Uh-huh.
It's like it's not a revelation. But God is able to keep you from falling. So even if you are weak,
mm-hmm,
he can make you stand.
Amen. That's right.
See, I think a lot of God's people just need to hear that, and they'd probably make a lot, tremendous,
yes,
amount of progress if they could just hear that and believe that. Yes, Brother Judah.
Yeah, here you've made a point of this already. He's able to keep you from falling backwards, but also gives you the ability to do what he's called you to do.
Oh, yeah.
So he doesn't leave you on your own either way. He doesn't keep you from falling, but then leave you to your own devices to do what he's called you to do. And he also doesn't leave you to your own devices so that you don't fall back into what you came out of, but give you the ability to do what he's called you to do. He gives you both.
That's right. Well, actually, if he keeps you from falling, that's part of that equation, as you have said. That's part of that equation. Mm-hmm. Part of the way he keeps you from falling is to keep this flame.
Yes, amen.
This flaming desire.
Yes.
See, people don't grow because they don't want to.
Yeah.
Yes, Brother Matthew.
Phrases that you just talked about, they have the same kind of effect on the church as the testimony of the 10 spies did on Israel.
Uh-huh.
And they actually really, without coming out saying it, are saying Satan is stronger.
That's right. See, there's we do have to face human weakness. Now there's a couple of ways you can face human weakness. One is you can try and soften the fact that it's human weakness and play up patience and long-suffering and things like this. But that won't work. I'll tell you right up front, that won't work. The other way is to inform the weak soul and to stand alongside of them to assist him in this, that God is able to keep you from falling. That's the other way. And that's the only really God-sanctioned way. God is able, Paul said, God is able to make all grace abound toward you. See, so he'd tell people, God is able to make him stand. See, God is able.
Amen.
God is able.
Well, by the way, did you know there's a well of water springing up
that's
in
right.
you?
That's right. See, but if a person is not made conscious of God himself, he will not conclude this.
Yes.
He can read all kind of Bible verses about what God's able to do. But if he doesn't know God and is not walking in the Spirit and not living by faith, he will just read right over them. He will not see them. So that's why we have to shout them out. Make people God conscious. Has to be understood that he does this through Christ. He just doesn't like put splints on you and make you stand. That's not it. He does it through Christ and through your faith. Now Peter states this specifically in 1 Peter 1:5. He says we are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. So your salvation is not finished yet. But when you say you're saved, you're just you're tentatively saved. The salvation is not done yet. Till you rise from the dead and stand before God, salvation is going on. So you don't, quote, get people saved. That's wrong terminology.
That's right.
You tell them what to do to be saved. Then they got the process has got to continue on till death.
Yeah.
Kept by the power of God through faith. Now that statement was made to your faith, not your intellect. That's not something you store in your intellect.
Yeah.
I mean, it should be in your intellect, understand, but it's addressed to faith. You've got to believe that.
Amen.
And so I would do you believe that? God keeps you through his power. God keeps you by his power through your faith. Do you believe that? See, if you believe that, then you'll be working on this faith. You'll be building yourself up on your most holy faith. You'll be working on that, on your faith, because God keeps you by the power, you're kept by the power of God through faith.
Amen.
And that backed up with God is able.
Amen.
See, God can do this.
Really given, I can remember thinking, I believe that, at least I said I did, but I would always attach something else to it. I know he keeps you by the power of God through faith and your involvement, but see, that's not what it says.
Yeah, see, here's what happened. We've talked about this a lot. Let's say that you quote this, you know this verse. Now unto him is able to keep you from falling. And you add, But don't forget, you can fall away. You have diffused and depowered that text. God does say this, but he does say about falling away, but not here. He never puts that back to back with a statement about God's ability, with the power of faith. So people neutralize texts by doing that. Go ahead, Brother Jason.
Yeah, I think the problem is with some of the terminology that people use. And fall away, to fall away, it's not like something accidental.
That's right. Yeah.
That's not what it means. It's not like falling off a log. It's not. It's an intentional turning away.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's falling back. It's an act of the will. It's something that you do.
Right.
It's not something that just. It's not you losing your salvation is not like losing your car keys.
That's
not
right.
Now, where did I put that salvation? Now I know it was around here somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
That's not.
No.
It's not. It's not something that you just wake up one morning and oh my goodness, I think I've lost my salvation.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But there's a lot of clumsy teaching about this.
I know it. You're right. It's that you leave the first love.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't tell Ephesians they lost their first love. He said they left.
Yeah.
In other words, they were lured off the path.
Yes.
And we know from Scripture that this is Satan. He's a master at getting people off the right track. That's what he did to Eve. He got her off the track.
Mm-hmm.
But he couldn't do it till she wanted to eat that fruit. So nobody sins unless they want to. You can't sin inadvertently unless it's a sin of ignorance. I understand that. You just don't know that that's the case.
Mm-hmm.
But this is right. From falling. Fall is when you get off the road. You're off the road and off the path. And any sin can potentially do that.
Yeah, that's right.
You can sin if not arrested, if not confessed, if not abandoned. Any sin can lead to falling.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Yeah. Yes.
You pointed out how people, they almost negate the promise by emphasizing that one can fall, but the statement itself implies that you can fall.
Yes.
It didn't need to be said.
That's right.
If we already didn't know, we could fall.
That's right.
He's able to keep us from falling.
Very good.
So we know we could fall.
Yeah.
So that is an imminent danger.
Right.
That's right.
Otherwise, this text means nothing.
Amen.
And it's a call to be absolutely dependent on the Lord, that He is able. When we emphasize what we do, we know what great things happen when we do.
You know, go ahead.
It's a matter of coming to the place where we love God so much that we utterly despise how we have sinned.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And that calls for complete humility before Him to accept
amen.
That we want to follow Him and not continue in what we've been in.
Yes, amen.
If I might share with you, one of the most disconcerting experiences I had when I first started preaching was I realized a lot of these people don't believe. It's very disconcerting. And I talked to them for a while and they didn't. They weren't what the Bible calls believers. They were just on the roster. Now you find, they weren't all that way, I understand, they weren't all that way, but that's what made the ones that were real believers very precious. And you'd have this little nucleus of close associates. But I didn't realize that condition was as dominant as it is. And it's worse now than it was, far worse than it was when I first started.
Yeah.
A lot worse.
Yeah.
Wasn't that alarming to you, Brother Gene? You seen that, didn't you?
I have. I've seen it for years and years.
Yeah.
It's great. It just makes your work oppressive.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You try to be charitable about it, but finally you finally realize they're not trusting. That's why these things don't mean anything to them. That's why they don't understand. This is why. They're not believing.
Mm-hmm. Some years ago in a sermon, this has been years ago, 15, 16 years ago, I said something along this line. I was preaching from Psalm, I'll never forget it. I was preaching from Psalm 119, a section that talked about that brought these thoughts to mind, yeah, about being faithful and those who were dealing with those who were not faithful and so forth. And in the assembly that morning, I said, because I knew it was true, that some of you are here just for family. Hmm. Some of you are here just out of habit. Some, and you talk about an explosion. I was attacked over that.
Yeah.
In fact, that may have been the point at which the relationship between me and the other leaders began to fall apart. How dare you say such a thing?
Yeah.
Some of those people may leave.
No.
I said, really? Well, if the shoe fits.
Yeah.
I didn't back down about it. I'd been there for months, and I could see this. It was obvious as could be. And so I just said it. I didn't name any names.
Mm. One time, I visited here from Indiana to make some films at Good News. And I was visiting Brother Don DeWelt, who was a personal friend of mine, and they had a four-state Christian men's meeting that night, and Don preached. So I went, oh boy, it was a wonderful sermon. Most of the people had no idea what he was talking about at all, except some of the old soldiers of the faith. So we were riding home, and it was quiet in the car, and Brother Don tearfully said, they didn't even know what I was talking about. There's a burden. Mm-hmm. And he did everything he could to address the problem. Uh-huh. But he saw that more needs to be done. So, see, well, nothing will be done about it until somebody's, like, concerned about it. And Jude, here you have an example. Yeah. You have an example in Jude of what to do. First, you tell about, look, you didn't cook up these ideas on your own. Somebody taught you to think this way.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
Then he tells them what kind of people they were. Yeah. Now he's telling them what God can do. Mm-hmm. He can keep you from falling. Now some versions say stumbling, which is technically what it means. Keep you from stumbling. Jesus said if you walk in the light, you won't stumble. Because Jesus is, as you know this already, but Jesus is a foundation stone.
Yeah, uh-huh.
But he is also a stumbling stone.
Right. Yeah.
If you walk in the light, you won't stumble over Jesus. He's, when people sin, they've stumbled over Jesus.
Yeah, uh-huh.
That's what's happened. But if you walk in the light, you won't stumble. Yeah. If you walk in the darkness, you'll stumble. In other words, God is able to keep you where he placed you. Think of it that way. If you're stumbling, you're stumbling or falling out of where he placed you. God is able. You got to trust him to do this, though. This is through your faith. God is able to keep you where he puts you. He puts you in Christ. He raised you up and made you sit together with Christ in heavenly places. He's able to keep you there. If you just trust him, he'll keep you there. Well, that's a great
promise.
That is a great promise, I'll tell you. If any man walk in the day, he stumbleth not because he sees the light. 1 John 1:9-10. Jesus said, abide in me. That's what he was saying.
Yeah.
Abide in me equates walk in the light. It's the same thing he's talking about. Abide in me, and then John wrote, abide in him. He told us to abide in him. So as long as we're walking in the light and abiding in Christ, God will keep us from falling. He will keep any intrusion away.
Yeah.
He will stop someone from being able to snatch you away.
Just considering whenever we are convinced of this, then we'll walk forward in the strength that he gives with this knowledge. Considering a parallel of Peter getting out of the boat during the storm to walk on the water, because he knew that Jesus was there, and Jesus is the one that called him.
Yeah.
So when he knew that Jesus was able to keep him from falling, he stepped out onto the water and walked to Jesus.
Amen.
Go there.
Peter, another example of this, of his denial of Jesus. Peter overestimated his own strength.
Mm-hmm.
He underestimated the assault of the devil.
Mm-hmm.
But Jesus kept him from falling.
Yeah. Yes.
It didn't mean that Peter owned no no fault, or he owned no guilt, but Jesus kept him from fault.
Amen. Yes, Sister June.
Yeah, this goes back to what the scripture talking about, that those of us that are being saved, there's no time when we don't need a Savior. And just Jesus had to be strong to retrieve us from sin, he has to be strong to keep us from sin.
Amen.
You see, when you see it, it's relatively simple. But if you don't, it is hard to understand. It is. In other words, no person has to say, and end the sentence by saying, I'm vulnerable. I am weak. We know that. But that's not the end. That's so you can't end there. You have to say now. You have to have this now. That Judas said, now unto him. Now that we know what you are, let's point it toward what God is. Yes, go ahead.
Several times we've talked about getting above our circumstances.
Amen.
This is how we do that.
Yes, amen. Amen.
That's good.
Yeah.
Amen. Yes, Sister Ava.
It's the truth that it's really not enough to be miserable in one sin.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of times people confuse that. It's doing some kind of work there, but it's Satan's ploy to get people stuck there, where they think just because they feel miserable and broken, and yet they find they continue to go to the same sin and indulge themselves. But that has to be overruled by an absolute desperation, so to speak, to know and belong to God above everything else. That when we want God more than anything else, that's what gives the power over the sin.
Amen.
And that has to happen because the sorrow has to lead to repentance.
Amen.
To be of some power.
Yeah, some people misevaluate the trial because they judge it too soon. Now, see, Peter, he could testify on the way back to the boat. He can keep you from falling.
That's right.
He can keep you. See, and some people will say, but he fell. No, he walked back with Jesus. Yeah, he kept him from falling.
That's right.
Yes. Amen.
Brother Gavin?
Yes, Brother Rick.
You know, the scriptures has proved that godly people can maintain boldness in the midst of perilous circumstances.
That's right. Amen.
Like David. Facing Goliath, you're walking on the sea, and the three Hebrew children facing a fiery furnace. You don't have to be free from dangerous circumstances to have boldness and confidence.
Amen.
Because your boldness is not tied to your circumstance. It's tied to your God.
Amen.
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 Amen. The potency and effectiveness of faith, unfortunately, is rarely expounded in circles that I've traveled in, at least. But it must be. This has got to be ministered to the people of God. The effectiveness of faith. This is part of being nourished up in the words of sound doctrine, as Paul would say it. See, the misconceptions and errors that have been birthed in this meager spiritual environment that we're in today, and we're in a meager spiritual environment, the misconceptions and errors are staggering in number. It's the same thing has happened of which Isaiah wrote in Isaiah 59:15. Truth faileth, and he that departeth from evil maketh himself a prey. Now, many of you have found this to be so. It's because of your faith people have preyed on you. See, that's a commentary on your faith, and it's also a commentary on the times. So, in other words, there's a need to say this. But let's not quit there. He's able to keep you from falling. And, see, I love that word, and. God is able to keep from falling, but there's a reason why. Just keeping you from falling, that's not the reason he keeps you from falling. But some people think that is. See, they think, well, I didn't do too bad today. Seemed to be doing pretty well. I didn't make any major blunders anyway. But see, that's not what salvation is about. Salvation is just not about today. It happens today, but there's this and to present you. Oh, he's getting me ready for a presentation.
Yeah.
And to present you, to bring you safe to that point, that appointed time of presentation. For the saints of God, it'll be a time of display. Here's what my grace did.
Yeah, amen.
And it's not going to be someone that was wallowing around in sin when he was in the world. Because grace doesn't do that.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. It's not going to be someone that fell backward off the course. Because that's not what grace does. You're going to be a trophy of grace. This is what God is targeting. This world is emphatically not the main world. And if a person's religion treats it as though it was the main world, they're just open to the devil because he's the god of this world. See? To present you. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, he told them what his objective was. That I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ. That's my aim. My aim is that you haven't played the lover with false gods. When you stand before Christ, you've been 100% devoted to him. You're chaste and you're pure. See? Now, I don't like to talk about things like this, but I must mention it because we have a number of young people that are at that, they're at the age of beginning adulthood. And you're going to be faced with temptations that have to do with the lust of the flesh. We'd like to say you won't, but I mean, fact of the matter is you will. And I'm right now, when you know, you got to make up your mind. I'm going to crucify the flesh.
Amen.
If I'm with that fine young man or that fine young woman and I'm with her for long enough, I'm beginning to have bad ideas, it's time to get up and go home.
Yeah.
You got to get away from it.
That's right.
You can't do it. He's able to present you faultless before the throne, and that's the aim. You can say, whoa, wait a minute now.
Yeah.
This is going a little bit too far.
Yes.
Going a little bit too far.
Uh-huh.
If I do this, I'm not going to be ready for the presentation.
Yeah. Amen.
Mm-hmm. Then God will use your faith and keep you from.
That's right. Amen.
Yes. I say, well, I won't say anymore. That ought to be plain enough, but. That's the way it is. Jesus didn't die and raise from the dead and go back to heaven just to get people's, quote, saved.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm sorry, that sounds nice. You could write books about it, build colleges on it, and all this sort of thing. I understand. I never did figure out why they called Matthew 28:18 the Great Commission. I never have figured out who did that or why they did it. Why not call, take up your cross and follow me, the Great Commission?
Yes, amen.
Or seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Why did they call that the Great Commission? Why did they call this? Because you can capitalize on it. I'll tell you why. Because they can capitalize on it. But when that's the outer court. See, that's coming to God.
Yeah.
And when they're measuring the temple in Revelation, God gave them a reed to do some measuring. Don't measure the outer court.
That's right.
It's been given over to the Gentiles. So that approach to God, that'll be corrupted. So don't stay there. The main thing is to get in there. There is a way.
Yes.
I mean, you do have to go through the outer court. You do have to go through the outer court. But that's not where you're. But Jesus didn't die just so you'd get in the outer court.
Amen.
He died so you'd be forever with the Lord. That's why. And if that isn't met, there's no purpose to his death.
Yeah. Amen.
No purpose at all. Once that's seen, it's just great. Present you faultless before his throne. Well, how about it? If you were to have to leave the world tonight, I mean, how would you? What's your opinion? I'm not asking you to answer. But what is your opinion? How would you be? Would you be faultless, or would there be a bunch of stuff brought up? You got to think about that.
Amen.
Now you're living in the now. So now he's able to keep you from falling. See the sense of this text? Now he's able to keep you from falling. So you just apply that. God's keeping us in order for the scheduled presentation, which is going to be for his glory. And he's going, how's he going to present us? He's not going to present you in spite of everything you did. Not going to be, I managed to overcome everything they did. I managed to overcome the way they lived. And it got them here anyway. He's going to present you faultless.
Yeah.
Pooh, that's a strong word. Blameless, some versions say. I mean, when the books are opened of your works, they're going to perfectly be coordinated with the book of life.
Amen. Yep.
Perfectly coordinated. He's going to present you faultless. I don't see how that's possible. The blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sin.
Yes.
And that's an ongoing, as long as you're in the world, that's an ongoing ministry. In fact, like 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us. But 1 John 1:7 says, if you walk in the light as he is in the light, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin.
Yeah.
No confession mentioned there. Why not? Because, well, I get the picture that a lot of this isn't things we know ourselves. It's something which we're not aware of ourselves. But if you're walking in the light, God will take care of that, illuminate it. Illuminate it to you, so you can go to sleep tonight absolutely perfect.
Yeah, amen.
You just confess your sins and you be absolutely perfect. Tomorrow you'll have to do the same thing. I understand that, but the point is that this is not an impossible condition.
Yeah.
Because of the blood of Christ, those who are not living see in harmony with the Lord. They're not walking in the light. They don't have this benefit. You see, they don't have this benefit. The prospect of being faultless before his throne depends on whether or not they acclimate themselves to the arrangement of salvation, which is walking in the light and living by faith and living in the Spirit. See, if you do this, this will be done. And anything that you don't know about, sometimes we don't know what to pray for as we ought. The Holy Spirit, he's making intercession from within. Then there's walking in the light, and it's a cleansing that goes on there. Then there's your own consciousness of failure, and you confess that, and the cleansing going on there. And when you finally get to glory, you'll be rid of the body, which is the source of all the trouble, and this will be fulfilled. You'll be glad. You'll see it then. This will be what you want.
Amen.
No one in sound mind wants to appear faulty before God.
No.
I mean, no one in their right mind wants that. So he tells you, now God's able to do this now. Remember what he said, God's able to do this. He's able to keep you from falling. It's getting off the course, getting out of Christ. He's able to keep you from that and to present you without any kind of fault at all before God. And that's not the end of it there. With exceeding joy. How about that? So you're not going to be trembling in the day of judgment. There's times when you're in the world, you'll think that's the way it's going to be. Oh, boy. You will not be trembling.
Amen.
You'll be rejoicing.
Yes.
He'll give you a pretty good hint right off the bat when all the sheep are together and all the goats are together.
Right.
You ought to be able to survey the crowd and say, well, this looks pretty good up to this point. The day of judgment will bring joy to the saints with everything that's necessary to prepare for standing before the Lord in the fullness of his glory. See, remember, you're going to stand before the Lord in his glory, the fullness of his glory. So you're not going to be like at the mountain where his foot touched the mountain and it shook. It's not going to be like that. God's going to just be unveiled. And there aren't going to be veils handed out to hang over your face.
Yeah.
You're going to see God just exactly as he is. That vision, for some people, will mean damnation.
Yeah, that's right. Uh-huh.
For those that were kept by the power of God through faith, it will mean salvation.
Yeah.
See? And so that's what all this is about. That's what the whole economy of salvation is about. It's about that presentation.
Amen.
There's going to be cherubim, seraphim, living creatures, 24 elders, an innumerable company of angels going to be standing by beholding this. What God made out of these people is going to redound to His glory. That's not the way they started out. All of them started out, they were made sinners. That's what the Scripture says. They were condemned. That's what the Scripture says. Look what the Lord has done.
Amen.
What a wonderful work. Now, our job, brethren, is just to fall in line with it. Believe it. Stir one another up. If you feel weak, I know about this. How to? If you do, then don't say to one another, well, I was weak too. I mean, I know what it's like to be weak. Well, I do know what it's like to be weak, but that's not what I'm, I think I should tell you that God's able to keep you from falling. I think that's better. And if we stir up one another with this, you'll end up feeding one another. It'll spread throughout the assembly that God's able. That's why the early brethren, when they were first persecuted, they prayed, remember, and drew to God's attention the Herod and Pontius Pilate and the leaders of the people, the Gentiles and the Jews were gathered together against the Lord and His Christ. They knew God was able. That's why they prayed that. They knew God was able.
Amen.
So we got, brother, we prayed for some people tonight. We've got to believe God is able.
Yes.
Trust in it. All right, I'll quit there. Any of you have a word you'd like to add tonight?
Last thing you said about standing faultless in His presence.
Yeah.
That's what Paul was talking about when he said he wanted to lay hold on that for which Christ laid hold on him.
That's right.
If you're not careful, you kind of, your spiritual life can kind of get out of kilter because you're not maintaining a view of primarily why God saved you. Yeah. Primarily, God saved you for Himself.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
It isn't to win the lost or just to show so you could witness to your wife or raise your children. Those are all good things in the proper priority. But primarily, God saved us for Himself.
That's right.
And that's what we're preparing for.
Boss. Yeah. Yes, Brother Rick Jason.
Yeah, that being presented faultless, that explains why we are left in the world in the body. He's making us that way. In the world in the body. There's a sense in which don't misunderstand me when I say this, but this is purgatory in a sense.
I know what you're saying, yes.
The Catholic doctrine of purgatory is that you die and you go to this place that's not heaven or hell, and then your soul is purified so that you can go on to heaven. Well, in actuality, purgatory is now.
You're being purified now.
You're being purified now. I don't know that we should call it that.
Yeah,
it's confusing,
but I
think all of you understand what I'm saying.
This is the place of purification. You're right.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right, we'll have a word of prayer. All right, Heavenly Father, we're thankful, grateful, and there are no words to express what it means to us that You're able to keep us from falling.
Yes,
we found this to be so. You've demonstrated it as we've walked by faith. Most of us can recount the various places where it is astounding that at that point we didn't fall away. And yet You kept us from falling. We thank You and praise You for it, Father, and help us to make this known abroad. In Jesus' name, amen.